If you want talk, games, and fun all rolled into one, well, you've come to the right place. This is The Game Show, where host Bradley Clarke and his special guests talk about the world of television game and competition shows. But Bradley's guests aren't here to just talk. They came to play a game as well. What will today's topic be? What game does Bradley have planned? There's only one way to find out.
It's time to start the show.
You heard the man. Welcome to The Game Show. And here's your host, the Bradster himself, Bradley Clarke.
I love moving and grooving to that theme song. Thank you so much, Austin Angelo, and welcome everybody to another exciting episode of The Game Show, the talk show all about the world of television game and competition shows. I'm Bradley Clarke, the Bradster, and today I'm welcoming on a first-time guest who has experienced many facets of the game show industry over the course of his television career, including being the host of two game shows, as well as portraying a game show host for a progressive insurance TV commercial. However, I think my guest is best known for being a game show contestant because he was involved in one of the most dramatic and exciting moments in game show history. Back in the 1980s, daytime game shows were still very popular, and in April of 1985, my guest was a grand champion on one of the most successful game shows of the decade. Now, I think we can all probably agree that $5 today might not seem like a lot of money, but 36 years ago, $5 was the difference between my guest winning or losing over $100,000 in cash and prizes.
Well, we finish up the game with a speed round. 60 seconds on the clock, please. Mark has been brilliant in the speed round, and he better be now because he is trailing. Howard at 35, Deborah at 30, Mark at 25. We start the speed round now. Who was Sherlock Holmes' faithful companion? Howard?
Mr.
Time. Name Johnny Carson's regular band leader. Mark?
Doc Severinsen.
Right. In Peter Pan, who was the villainous captain? Deborah?
Hook.
Right. To Granddad, what was a Pierce arrow? Howard.
Car.
Right. What part of your body would you place in the care of an orthodontist? Deborah.
Your teeth.
Right. What type of vegetable is a scallion? Mark.
Onion.
Right. In the song, what color ribbon was tied around?
Yellow.
Right. During the Battle of Trenton, what river did George Washington? Howard.
Delaware.
Right. Who wrote the beloved holiday songs White Christmas and Mark?
Irving Berlin.
Right. What number is represented by the Roman numeral M? Deborah.
Thousand.
Right. In what holy city would you find the Wailing Wall?
Jerusalem.
Right. Name the English poet and novelist who wrote Gunga Din. Deborah.
Kipling.
Right. What do you collect if you're a philatelist? Mark.
Stamps.
Right. What's the term for a poem containing only 14? Mark. Time. You lose five. Name the commit. Time is up. We've got a tie. We have a tie. Howard, you are out of it. You cannot answer. It is between Deborah and Mark. Remember, if you answer incorrectly, you lose five, you would lose. Answer correctly, you add five, and you would win. An Indian woman named Sacagawea led Deborah.
Pocahontas.
No! She led Lewis and Clark! You've done it! Deborah loses $5! Congratulations! Wow! Deborah, great match. You were great players. Mark, get over here! Whoa. You've done it!
After a bad buzz-in during the final seconds of the speed round and an intense tie-breaking situation, my guest ultimately felt the thrill of victory by winning a $50,000 cash jackpot and a total of $115,257 in cash and prizes on Sale of the Century. Throughout my lifelong studies of the game show genre, I've come to know him as one of the greatest Sale of the Century winners and the host of shows like Studs and Big Deal. However, growing up, I knew him as the voice of Hugh Neutron from the movie Jimmy Neutron Boy Genius and the TV series The Adventures of Jimmy Neutron Boy Genius on Nickelodeon. Celebrating his 36th sale-iversary this year, please welcome onto the game show, Mark DeCarlo. Mark, thank you so much for joining me today.
What a fantastic intro that was, Bradley. No one's ever said 36th sale-iversary before. I love it.
I'm a big fan of game show history and making sure everyone knows when specific dates are and when anniversaries come up. So, of course, I'm going to say your 36th sale anniversary.
That was a great week. I was at UCLA, flat broke, And all I wanted to do is go on that game show and make enough money to buy a convertible VW Rabbit. And I ended up with a beautiful convertible Toyota Celica GTS. Woo!
If you wanted a luxury car, that was the show to go on.
Yeah, exactly. It was super, super fun. And it changed the trajectory of my life in every way possible.
And I know this is not a game show, but Jimmy Neutron literally was my childhood. I would watch the show all the time. I still remember when I was 4 years old going to see the movie in theaters. It was one of my first movies I've ever saw in a theater. And Hugh was one of my all-time favorite characters between his ducks and his love of pie. You've shared the stage with Jim Perry and you've won all this money and you've hosted game shows. But to talk with Hugh Neutron is extra special.
That's great to hear.
I can't believe it, Sugar Booger. We're finally going to get to see Ducks, the greatest musical ever made. When you're a duck, you're a duck all the way. From the first time you quack to the last egg you lay. When you're a duck, you live in a blind with a little orange and some fresh melon rind. The musical.
Don't tell the others, but you're my favorite.
Hugh!
Oh, hi, honey.
Are you going to spend the entire day with your duck collection?
Yeah, just a minute, Dough Dumpling. I'm finishing up the flock's monthly fluff and buff.
But hey, look at all the pie! Yes! I will do it! I will live!
Jimmy Neutron was the first nerdy character who was a hero on a show, whether it's cartoon or live action. You know, usually the nerdy kid was the butt of the joke. But on Neutron, Jimmy, his inventions and his inventiveness would always cause the trouble and then fix the trouble. And it was the dad that was the idiot, which was very fun to play.
A likely story? What would Dad possibly want with your rubber gloves?
Hey, boys! Look at me! I'm Cocky the Rooster Man! Cock-a-doodle-doo! Cock-a-doodle-doo! Hey, Mother Hen! Want to have a pecking party? Make way for Rooster Man! Half rooster, half man, all you!
Well, maybe that's why I love the show, because it was a nerdy character who always got into trouble.
Yeah, I was a nerdy kid when I was younger. My wife is a total science fiction nerd. And there were role models when you were growing up. The leads of the shows were always the handsome, strong football player types. And we kind of rewrote the rule book there with some very talented writers, Stephen Banks and Steve Odenkirk and Gene Grillo and a bunch of other guys. It was a great experience for us, both the film and the television series.
Well, I don't like to say nerd. I like to say intellectually inclined. And the love of knowledge that you had growing up certainly showed off when you were on Sale of the Century. And that's what we're going to be talking about today. And then later on, Mark, for the game of the day, it's been 36 years since you won $115,257 on Sale of the Century. But hopefully your winning streak will continue just without the six-figure payday when you play a Sale of the Century-inspired game that I created.
Love it.
So are you ready to talk about Sale of the Century with me?
Oh my gosh, Bradley, I am.
So you appeared on the show back in April of 1985. Prior to going on Sale, were there any other game shows that you tried out for, or were there any game shows that you dreamed of becoming a contestant on?
Not at all. I was a student at UCLA, and I was doing stand-up comedy and going to school and having a good time, and I needed a car. I was driving my grandpa's old 1978 Malibu, and I wanted a cool car. I wanted a convertible because I had moved to California from Chicago, and you got to have a convertible here. So I thought, what's the easiest way to get money to buy a used convertible? And back then, every Sunday in the LA Times, the front page of the classified section, they'd have ads for all these crazy things. And there were a lot of game show ads. Come and try out. Come and try out. And there was a big, long ad. Come and try out for a show. You have to be personable and know a lot of trivia. So I went down to an old church in Westwood, and there were 300 or 400 people, and they had you stand up and say your name, a little bit about yourself, and then you took a test. And then after the test, they graded the test, and they kicked out most of the people, and there were probably 50 of us left. And then they interviewed us in more detail after that. And then a couple days later, they called me and said, okay, you're going to be on the show. And I think one of the secrets to my success was they called me into the studio 5 days before I actually got on the show. So I watched about 20 episodes being taped and got to the point where it was boring to watch the shows. But I think by listening to that many episodes, I subliminally got the rhythm and the cadence of the way they wrote the questions. It wasn't Jeopardy, but it wasn't an easy show either. And they would sometimes tease the answer or give you an insight or a clue to an answer, depending on how the question was written and phrased. And I think I just kind of internalized that. So when they finally called my name to go on the show that Tuesday morning, I was more than ready. And I had done a bunch of plays and I had done a lot of comedy up to that point. So being in a soundstage with cameras and people wasn't distracting for me either. And I think it is for a lot of civilians, people that aren't in show business. There's so much going on behind the cameras that you don't see at home, but you see it as a contestant and it can be distracting. So I don't think I was distracted by any of that. And I was bored and ready to roll. And Jim Perry, God love him, was the sweetest, nicest, most generous guy. I talked to him during the commercial breaks and he found out that I was an aspiring comedian. And at every possible chance, he would kind of plug my career and set me up for jokes and have fun with me on camera to a degree that I hadn't seen him do with other people. And it was just wonderful. One of the highlights of my life was 6 years later, when I was hosting Studs, Jim came to the studio and I got to introduce him. And it was really cool.
Hello there. I'm Jim Perry. We're delighted to have you join us for Studs. You know, a couple of years ago, Mark DeCarlo was a guest on my show, Sale of the Century, and he's very modest, so he wouldn't tell you this, but he was the biggest money winner we've ever had.
Jim, when I said that there was ever anything I could do for you, I didn't really mean to come on the show and stuff.
Yeah, but I was...
But it's great to see you. And we can, like, go out after the show and have some coffee or something? Jim Perry, ladies and gentlemen! Give him a Jim explained, we've got a fabulous show, three women who went out with two guys, they were all blind dates, so let's go and see what happens, shall we?
It turns out one of the writers, Lois Curran, ended up being a producer on Studs 6 years later. And I didn't meet her when I was doing Sale of the Century, but one of the early days of Studs, she walked up to me and she goes, I know you and you don't know me. And she explained what happened. And the questions were written in a very clever way, I think. And it was a fun show to watch, fun show to play. There was strategy involved. When do you buy the instant bargains? When do you don't? And I think the woman that I beat for my 11th show played the game completely wrong because she was incredibly cocky.
And we're going to talk in detail about that all-important 11th game for you. But before we do that, I do want to ask, in October of 1984, the shopping element of Sale of the Century was changed to the winner's board format, meaning instead of accumulating money over the course of several days to buy a prize, every time you won a game, you received a prize that you matched on the board after the game was over. Brad fact! Now, I personally did not like the winner's board because it defeated the whole purpose of Sale of the Century, which was earning money in the main game to ultimately purchase a prize at a bargain price. But I do get why the show wanted to implement an element that involved a prize being won on each episode. So Mark, did the idea that you didn't have to risk anything every time you played as a champion, aside from the chance to play for the $50,000 in cash, have any influence on you auditioning for the show when you did?
I would love to say, Bradley, that I had gamed it out and thought about it that deeply, but the truth is, no. I read the different ads for the game shows, and this was one where they were emphasizing personality and fun, and I thought that would play to my strengths. And I don't even know if I had seen the show when I auditioned for it. Literally, my entire focus was to scrape together $3,000 to buy a convertible, and I would have been happy. So when I started winning, the money accrued really quickly. And by the end of the first show or the second show, I had surpassed what my goal had been. So it was all frosting after that, which I think also helped me not get too nervous until the very, very last show.
Now, you were a contestant on 11 episodes of Sale of the Century. Now, usually game shows shoot 5 a day. So I'm curious what the taping schedule for you was like for Sale of the Century. And was it mentally exhausting to play so many games in a row?
No, I don't think it was. I think once I got into the groove, I liked playing game after game after game because it's like sports. You know, I was hot and I was loose and I was ready to go. And everyone that was coming in to play me had A, just watched me play. So I think they were a little intimidated and they were cold. The shooting schedule was perfect too. As I told you, I went and sat for 5 days before I actually got picked to be on the show. What they do for all game shows is if they're going to need, let's say, 5 contestants for the day, they have 15 contestants there. And then at the beginning of every show, they randomly pick the players for that show so that there's no collusion and there's no trickery. This is still going back to the game show scandals in the 50s. So the first show taped at 1 o'clock on Tuesday, the 19th of March. And then we shot 5 shows that day. So we did shows from like 1 o'clock to about 9 o'clock at night. I won every single one of them. Felt great. I went back to my one bedroom apartment that I was sharing with my buddy Ted. And we went out and we had a great time that night. Went back the next day, which was Wednesday, the 20th of March, again at 1 o'clock. Shot 5 more shows, rolled over a lot of other people. And then in the last show of the day, they give you the option. I had $50,000, $60,000 in cash and prizes. And they say, all right, you can take the $60,000 and you can go home, or you can risk it all and come back for one more show. And if you win, we'll give you a $50,000 bonus on top of everything. If you lose, you lose everything except for the mixers and the small little prizes you get along the way. And because I had done so well in those 2 days, I was like, sure, I'll do it, whatever. And then I had Thursday off to think about the implications of what I had risked. And then Friday, the call time was 8 a.m. And I am not a morning person. I'm a stand-up comedian, an improviser from Second City. So I'm a night person. But Jim Perry was living in Toronto at the time. So he wanted to shoot and get on a plane so he could be home at a decent hour Friday night. So 8 o'clock in the morning, I dragged my butt from Westwood to Burbank. I'm tired. I'm out of it. I have had a day and a half with all my friends talking to me and calling me, and to think about, oh my gosh, I've won all this money, but I could piss it away if I screw up today. And you can hear it in the opening segment of that 11th show. My voice is a little higher. I was nervous. I was tight. One of the questions was, what city would you be in if you were in the loop? And I froze. I didn't even buzz in. And someone else buzzed in and Jim goes, Mark, you said you're from Chicago, right? And I go, yeah, I know. I don't know what happened. So I booted a bunch of questions. I was behind the whole game. It was brutal. And then it had a very exciting ending. So I think up until that last day, the schedule played into my particular strengths because it was afternoon and evening. And, you know, you get on a roll, basically, or at least I did.
And I have the stats for you, Mark. You actually...
Ah, of course you do, Bradley.
Up to the 10th game, you had $48,000 in prizes from the stage and a total of $64,038. So even if you went for it, you'd still win over $16,000 worth of stuff, but you were risking $48,000 worth of other things. Brad fact!
Right. So at the end of the 10th episode on that second day, I had about $64,000 in prizes. And they ask you if you want to come back and risk it all for another 50. And I said, sure, because I had beaten everyone by quite a sizable margin up until that point.
That's for the fine champion, Mark DeCarlo. Now, Mark, you have picked up a lot of prizes along the way. I said you're going to have to take a risk. Let me go over a couple of things with you. You have picked up 10 wonderful prizes. Among the prizes you've picked up, beautiful pearl necklace. You have picked up that all-terrain vehicle. You've got yourself a fur coat. Wonderful cruise to Mexico. Sports car I know you love. $3,000 in cash, and now $10,000 in cash. In total, that's around over $48,000 in cash and prizes. Now, you picked up other things with the fame game, the instant bargains. Forget about those. There's no risk involved with those. We're talking about a risk with those major prizes. And what we are thinking about adding, if you wanted to take the risk, is this.
$50,000 in cash!
So this is the way it stands. You haven't had to make any decisions up to now, and now you've got to make one. You can take the risk of all of those prizes. One more win, and you would have all of those prizes plus the $50,000 in cash. If you lose, you lose all of those major prizes. 10 seconds to make up your mind. Mark DeCarlo, are you going to risk $48,000 in cash and prizes in order to try to add $50,000 in cash more?
Well, I came here with nothing. I had a good time, so what the heck? I'll risk it and do it.
He's going to try for it. So he puts $48,000 on the line. One more win, he adds $50,000 in cash. It's all or nothing for Mark DeCarlo next time on Sale of the Century. Good
luck. The first show that I was on Tuesday, it ends with a tie between me and the current champion at the time. There was a tiebreaker, and I won. And then I won the next 9 shows rather handily. And then that last 11th show ends in a tiebreaker because I played so horribly, and I was so tight. And I didn't think I was nervous at the time, but when I watch the tape, which I do every year on March 22nd, clearly you can see that I'm very nervous and not loosey-goosey, which is no matter what you're doing, you have to be loose and relaxed to perform your best, and I certainly was not.
For obvious reasons, you didn't buy any instant bargains during your final two episodes. But prior to these two games, did you have a strategy going in that you were not going to make any main game purchases because you wanted to have the best chance at winning the game? And were there any instant bargains that you were tempted to buy but ultimately didn't because you wanted to keep your lead in the game?
The first few shows, all the instant bargains were kind of like housewifey, homemakery kind of things, like a dishwasher or a recliner or stuff that I didn't want. And I think after the first two or three shows, and I've been told this by my friends who were writers on the show who I befriended years later, they decided to start putting the instant bargains in for what a 20-year-old guy would want. So it was stereos and trips and things like that. So if I was really, really, really ahead, and it was the second or third instant bargain of the game, and it was a trip, and I think I got a trip to Mexico, a trip to New Orleans, some stereos, some TVs. So stuff like that I would buy. But I didn't want to lose a game because I had lost $5 on a TV and then lose the game by $5. I thought that would be stupid strategy. So my goal was to win the game without any stress every single time and be far enough ahead where if someone comes on strong in the speed round, I can't get hurt. I was playing conservatively within the rules of the game until that last game where I decided to risk it and go for the bonus.
Now, Mark, I'm not sure if you know this or not, but you actually hold a very interesting sale of the century record. You were actually the first contestant in the history of the winner's board era of the show to clear the board of all 10 prizes and then risk those prizes to play an 11th game for the additional $50,000 in cash. Brad fact!
Oh, really?
Yeah, four people before you cleared the board but didn't end up trying for the $50,000 bonus. They decided the prizes were enough and they didn't go for the $50,000. Uh-huh. But you are the first person to actually go for the $50,000 and win.
I'll take that. Yeah. You know, like I said, it was all gravy at that point. And because it happened so quickly, you know, I had done 10 shows in 2 days. It's Monopoly money. You haven't touched it. You haven't seen it. They've just told you that you've won all these things, but you don't experience it. Plus, I was 20 years old and I didn't really care. It was all pretend to me. But in the day and a half between the 10th show and the 11th show, I had a lot of time to think about it and it clearly affected my performance. And they didn't invite me to the Tournament of Champions, which hurt my feelings, Bradley. You know people in the game show world. Can you fix that for me?
Well, believe me, if I could call the NBC executives and convince them to do a throwback Sale of the Century Tournament of Champions, I would in a heartbeat. But what's funny is I was actually going to bring up the Tournament of Champions because you had just missed the Sale of the Century 1985 Tournament of Champions since that took place in February of that year. But the show had another Tournament of Champions in 1988, but with only 9 players instead of 18 like in the 1985 tournament. Brad fact! So I was wondering the same thing myself. Why wasn't Mark DeCarlo invited back for the 1988 Tournament of Champions?
I don't know. And I became friends with some of the people that were on the show, the contestant coordinators, one of whom, Lisa Berger, went on to run MTV, and the writers. So I thought we were all on good terms. And then they did the Tournament of Champions, and I was not invited back. I didn't understand why.
I will make a promise to you. If I ever have any doings with bringing Sale of the Century back, I will bring you back for a Tournament of Champions.
Oh my God, that would be fantastic. Or, you know, it'd be fun to actually host an episode of it as a little tribute to Jim Perry, who was super nice to me.
Well, back in 2007, Sale of the Century was rebooted as a daytime syndicated game show called Temptation, the new Sale of the Century, which lasted a year. Did you get a chance to watch it, Mark?
I watched a little of it, but I thought it was a little, meh. It was invented by a group of marketing people in a room somewhere. It was a little too contrived, I thought. It was a classic old school TV game show with big flashy prizes and buzzers and stuff like that. You change it, you take a lot of the zip out of it, I think.
So now let's talk specifically about your 11th game in which you were trying to win an additional $50,000 in cash. As you mentioned, you started the game off slow and were missing a lot of questions. And going into the third and final Fame game, you were in third place with $25, and you trailed Deborah by $5 and Howard by $10. You did end up answering the question about John Adams correctly, but didn't find any of the money cards on the Fame game board.
Bouncing around. $10 separate the players, and as promised, the $25 money card is up on the board right now. Don't shout out an answer, please. Famous person. I was born in Massachusetts in 1735 and died July 4th, 1826. I graduated from Harvard and became a lawyer. I took a leading role in opposing British colonial policies, and the Stamp Act proved a turning point in my life. I helped draft and was a signer of the Declaration of Independence. As the second president of the U.S., Mark?
John Adams.
Yes, that's right. Mark?
I almost said Jefferson. I'm glad I said Adam. Okay, $25 money card is behind number five.
And behind number five, we have a food preparer. This KitchenAid mixer with attachments can handle almost every task, from the single egg white to kneading yeast dough. It's a complete food preparer furnished by KitchenAid.
Where were those big money cards?
Behind the number six, the number four, and the number three.
Number three have that big one.
So when number five on the board was revealed to be a food preparer and not one of the money cards, how destroyed were you in that moment, knowing that the speed round was coming up and that was your last chance to catch up?
They had to bleep me. I don't know if you can tell, but I was not happy. Obviously, I wanted that 25 card because I was missing questions. I wasn't buzzing in. At the first commercial break, I vividly remember this. I came out cold. I was trailing. The game's 5 minutes old, and I'm, oh, my God, we're going to break. I closed my eyes, and I had a visual of my red convertible driving away with money flying out of the back of it in just like a big black tunnel of despair. So when I didn't get the $25 money card, I said, and they bleeped me. Luckily, my head was down, and I don't think anyone noticed, but I wasn't happy. It was a bad day. Some days, you have good days. Some days you have bad days. And up to that point, I was just having a crappy day and I was nervous and there was pressure that I didn't think I was succumbing to, but clearly I was. And it just kind of snowballs on you. So by the beginning of the speed round at the end, like you said, I was trailing and took a big deep breath. And I'm like, all right, well, let's give it a shot.
With 7 seconds left on the clock, Jim asked, what's the term for a poem containing only 14 lines? The answer was sonnet, but you buzzed in and couldn't come up with the correct answer, causing you to lose $5. Now, Mark, I'm guessing based on your reaction when time was up that you were not able to see your score or your opponent's scores as the game was being played, correct?
No, that's another thing. So I blow that question. No, that's incorrect. You lose $5. The buzzer goes off and Jim says, we've got a tie. And I thought it was a tie between Howard and Deborah. So I thought at that point, I had lost. So I put my head down and I was depressed. And then he said something like, Howard, you're out, Mark and Deborah. And when he said that I was still in the game, suddenly everything was great. I felt fine. And he started reading that last question. And the way the game was set up, you had to have your hand on the buzzer. And then you would slap your thumb or the fat part of your wrist on the buzzer to buzz it. So he started reading the question. An Indian woman named Sacagawea led. And I didn't know the answer at that millisecond, but I twitched my hand to try and trick Deborah into buzzing in, and it worked. She buzzed in, and she didn't know. She lost $5, and I won in the most inglorious way possible to win, but I didn't care at that point. I just didn't want to lose the car.
See, this is the stuff that I love, the stuff that you don't see exactly on camera, but those little game show tidbits that only the people there know.
Yeah. And the speed at which I could hit that buzzer played a large part in my success on the show, just because, again, as we were talking about at the beginning, there was a certain cadence and rhythm to how they wrote the questions. So there was a little bit of a clue in the first part of the sentence. So as he was reading the John Adams question, for instance, I instantly knew it was either Adams or Jefferson. And then he said something else that made me think Adams, so I buzzed in. There's a universe of answers before they start reading the question. When he starts reading the question, that universe collapses until you are positive of the answer or you think you know the answer. And I was able to buzz in really quickly. And just because of where my hand was, it was right in Deborah's field of vision. And here's another little behind-the-scenes tidbit. Howard was a delight. Between every show, all the contestants would be herded back into a green room, like a cafeteria. And after the third show, we'd all have lunch together. And it was a very collegial, fun group. Everyone was friendly. Everyone was in a great mood, except Deborah. She was very full of herself. And at lunch that day, so this is Wednesday before the Friday, she was in the pool too. She walked up to me literally at lunch as I'm carrying my food around. She goes, I'm Deborah and I'm going to beat you. And I said, okay, give it your best shot. And she was very full of herself. She was going to win. And I don't want to be disparaging because she was not a horrible person. She was trying to work me. I was doing the same thing to everybody else. You try and play the game within the game. So fast forward to that moment after the tiebreaker, Jim starts reading the question. An Indian woman named Sacagawea led. and I deked her. I twitched my hand to make it look like I was going to buzz in, because I looked at her and you could tell her jaw was clenching. We were all nervous, but she was really, really tight. And I thought I could trick her into buzzing in before she knew the answer. I twitched. She buzzed in. She didn't know. She lost $5 and I won. So it's a little bit sneaky. And I did know the answer. I just didn't know it at that second. And who knows? I may not have known the answer. I don't know. But in the 30 plus years since that day, every year on March 22nd, which was the day that we shot that episode, I watch all the episodes and I'm always humbled by realizing that the trajectory of my entire life was completely changed by a stroke of chance and luck. It wasn't something that I won. Somebody else lost and I was the lucky recipient of that. So whenever I'm getting too full of myself, I remember that luck plays a part in life too.
Well, also put this in perspective. Your life was changed because of a $340 Frigidaire microwave and $200 in cash, because that was one of the instant
yes.
bargains that Deborah bought for $5. And if she didn't buy that, there would have never been a tie. She would have been in the lead.
Dumb. And I remember there's one point where I keep telling Jim to give more money.
$100 in cash.
$100 in cash? You could use the money.
$200 in cash.
$200.
More, said somebody. I'd love for one. $300 in cash.
$300
for $10. Mark is signaling more. Well, Mark's going for a lot. $500 in cash for $10.
That was an aspect of her cockiness. That's the word I was looking for earlier. She was really, really cocky.
What would a chef reach for if a recipe called for sodium chloride? Deborah?
Salt.
Sodium chloride is indeed salt. And Deborah hits the $40 mark. Well, Deborah, time for an instant bargain, of course. Player in the lead can buy bargain merchandise. Sales surprise with a cash bonus could come up. Deborah, right away, you've got a big lead. You've got a $15 lead over Howard. You've got a $20 lead over Mark. Can we interest you? Oh, this is nice, Deb.
Deborah, to make your cooking easier, here's Frigidaire's mid-sized microwave oven featuring touch control, a mealminder probe, and the full circle cooking system furnished by Frigidaire. It's normally priced at $340. And today on sale of the century, it's yours for only $5.
Lovely. Very lovely.
That's very nice.
That's a what, Mark?
That's very nice.
Isn't that nice? Mark thinks you... Mark likes that for you. I bet Howard does, too.
Yeah, I think so.
And Deborah, $340 it would normally cost. Good microwave. I mean, you...
That's very tempting.
Yeah, that's right. Just don't put plastic plants in there. That's all.
Oh, then I don't need it.
$5 it would cost... Well, if you don't need it, then I guess I'd be wasting my time to ask you if you wanted to take... $200 in cash with it. $540 bargain for just the value of one question.
That's sounding a lot better.
Going once, going twice. She likes the microwave. Enjoy the microwave and the cash. Cost you just $5 and you still have the lead. The $10 lead over Howard, $15 lead over the champion.
And in her position, I would have never done that. You're going against someone in a big game who's been winning. You just want to win the game. And she was so cocky. She bought both of them. And I remember thinking when she bought the last one, that was a huge tactical mistake, lady, and I'm going to make you pay for it.
Head, heart, hands, and health are areas of development for what young people's organization? What?
Boys Clubs of America.
No. Head, heart, hands, health, 4-H clubs, 4-H clubs. And again, Mark takes a backward step. $10 lead for Deborah. Deborah, great opportunity again to buy. Instant bargain. You have a $10 lead.
Mm-hmm.
How about this?
Deborah, for those times you want to kick up your feet, here's the Getaway Chair computerized massage lounger with a built-in AM-FM stereo cassette with wraparound speakers. It's designed for total relaxation, furnished by HWE Incorporated, and it's normally priced at $1,495. And today on sale of the century, it's yours for only $15.
Very nice. Very unusual. It's a lovely... Do you like the chair?
I like it very much.
Okay. $1,495. Now, Howard just made a lot of money with an instant bargain. Who knows? Another sales surprise. Never know. Mark is going for a lot of money.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to do two things.
Right.
I'm going to give him a sporting chance at the money he's going for and give you a sporting chance because you would be in a tie. I'll give you the chair,
mm-hmm.
not for $15, but for $10. You'd be in a tie with Mark. And if you bought the chair... For $10, I would give you $1,000 in cash.
That's real money.
You'll be in a tie with the champion.
Gotcha. Yeah. That's real money.
Going once, going twice, we've got a tie.
But she's got a microwave, so we're both happy.
Right, yeah. I wonder what she did with that $200 in cash.
You know what, though? After the taping was done, we celebrated. I watched the next episode, and a guy named Maury Filer won, who was hilarious. This old guy from here in L.A., really funny dude. And my dad happened to be in town on a business trip. So my dad and my roommate and Maury and Howard and Deborah and maybe one or two other people, we went across the street to Acapulco's, and we got pitchers of margaritas, and we had dinner, and Deborah was cool at that point, and everyone was happy. And at the end of the dinner, I'm like, Dad, I have no money. Can I borrow $400 to pay the bill? And he was happy to do that, but it was a crazy day.
Whether it be any of the prizes or any mementos you saved from your time on set, do you still have anything from your time on Sail of the Century?
I have the final cue card with all the prizes and the money and the totals on it. I have it hanging in my office. And I have a picture that the NBC photographer took of the moment where I'm kicking balloons at the end of the show, holding the bag of money with Jim and Summer Bartholomew and my dad and my friends that were there at the time. Like I said, I was in college. I was broke. I didn't really know what I was going to do in my career. And from that day forward, I had a big cushion of cash in the bank. So I told my parents, I'm going to give show business a try for 2 years. And if I'm not making a living doing show business, then I'll go get a job in advertising or I'll go get a regular job. So by having enough money to live on when I graduated from school, I didn't have the pressure of having to go wait tables or go work a day job like my other comedian friends. I started going on commercial auditions and acting auditions. And because I didn't have to book the job to make rent, I was relaxed and I started booking jobs. So it's not an exaggeration. If she had answered that question correctly, my whole life would have been different.
And we wouldn't have had Studs or Big Deal or possibly Hugh Neutron.
Quite possibly, yeah. I mean, who knows? That's the thing that always keeps me humble and grateful about life. And it's the same for everyone. You work hard, you try and prepare yourself so that when you get an opportunity, you can shine. But who knows what happens when you have those opportunities? And I know for a fact that it would be much more difficult to start a acting career if you're working three jobs and going on auditions. I would go and do comedy at night. I'd sleep till noon. I would goof off and hang out with my friends and go on auditions. And I had enough money to live. So it was a huge deal for me.
Well, a huge deal for me is being able to host a game for a game show host to play and being able to put my game show hosting skills to the ultimate test. So, Mark, are you ready to play a Sail of the Century-inspired game?
So ready, Bradley.
Well, it's time for the game of the day.
Game of the day.
Now, Mark, we've talked extensively about your appearance on Sail of the Century and even mentioned the game we are about to play because it is a classic Sail of the Century minigame. It's been over 35 years since you heard Jim Perry list off some clues in hopes that you would hit the buzzer with a correct answer and get the chance to pick one of the 9 numbers on the board that contain prizes and valuable money cards. I'm going to transport you back to 1985 as best as I can because you're once again going to have a chance to play the Fame Game. The Fame Game.
Oh, I love the Fame Game.
And here's how we play this version of the Fame Game. Just like on Sail of the Century, I will give you a category and then start listing off clues to the answer one at a time. After each clue, you'll let me know if you want to guess at the answer or hear another clue. If you correctly guess the answer after the first clue is read, you'll score 20 points, but for every clue you ask for afterwards, 2 points will be subtracted from the total number of points you can earn for a correct answer. Keep in mind there are only 10 clues per answer, and if you give me an incorrect guess, an additional 2 points will be subtracted, meaning the maximum number of clues you could ask for will decrease by one. A correct answer not only banks the points earned, but also allows you to pick one of the 9 numbers on the Fame Game board. 4 of the numbers contain an additional 10 points, 3 of the numbers contain an additional 15 points, and 2 of the numbers contain an additional 25 points. You'll play 2 categories, and Mark, in honor of you recently celebrating your 36th Sailiversary, your goal is to accumulate a total of 36 points or more.
I love it. Let's bring it on, baby.
So, Mark, over the course of your 11-day run on Sale of the Century, you played the Fame Game a total of 33 times. Are you ready to play another two rounds of the Fame Game right here on the game show?
I am so ready, Bradley.
Then let's play the Fame Game.
Oh, this is exciting. Yes, let's do it.
Remember, Mark, you need 36 points or more to win, and here comes your first category. Person. You're looking for a person, Mark, and here comes your first clue worth 20 points if you answer correctly. I was born with the last name Dooley in Camden, New Jersey in 1933.
I would like another clue.
Next clue. I worked on Armed Forces Radio during the Korean War.
Okay. Dooley. Give me another clue.
Okay, here's your third clue. Due to a conflict with AFTRA, when I started working in television, I adopted my mother's maiden name.
So this is the early 50s. We're in the East Coast. Someone with a last name Dooley. It's maybe a game show host. Let's see, how old would Jim Perry be? Is it Jim Perry? No, I take that back. He's Canadian. No, I would like another clue, please.
Another clue it is. Here's clue number four. I was the announcer on That Show, a 1969 talk show starring Joan Rivers that only lasted 2 months.
Man, another clue.
All right, here's your fifth clue, Mark, which is worth 12 points if you answer correctly. My family and I moved to Canada in the early 70s, but we moved back to the United States in the late 70s when I was hired to host an NBC Mark Goodson, Bill Todman game show.
Jim Perry. It's Jim Perry.
Are you locking in with Jim Perry?
I'm locking in Jim Perry.
For 12 points, which means you will be one third of the way to a victory. Is it Jim Perry? Yes, it is.
Yes.
A lot of people think Jim Perry is Canadian because he hosted game shows in Canada, but he's actually from New Jersey. Brad fact.
I did not know that. Oh, that was an excellent game, Bradley. Well done. Lots of jukes and jives in there. You had me off base.
In case you were wondering, here are some of the other clues. The next one would have been that game show was Card Sharks, followed by in 1982, I was hired to host another NBC game show that premiered on January 3rd, 1983. That's, of course, in reference to Sale of the Century. The clue after was that show was a revival. It was produced by Reg Grundy and it ran until March 24th, 1989. The two game shows he hosted in Canada were Definition and Headline Hunters. Those were going to be mentioned in the following clue. And if all else failed, the last clue would have been I made a cameo appearance on a 1991 episode of Studs.
Well done. Very good. Very good. So how many points did I get there?
You got 12 points, and now you get a pick at the Fame Game board. Remember, four cards have an additional 10 points, three cards have an additional 15 points, and two cards have an additional 25 points. Mark, 1 through 9, which number would you like?
Is the number 1 in the upper left-hand corner?
Of course it is.
Okay. 4.
Number 4, which is center left, and number 4 is worth 15 points.
All right. I got a shot at 36.
You certainly do, Mark. And now you have a total of 27 points, which means you are only 9 points away from the win. So if you can answer correctly within clues 1 through 6, victory is yours. The second category is TV show. We're looking for a TV show, Mark.
Okay.
And here is your first clue. This TV show's main character was created in the 1980s, but it wasn't further pursued.
I have an inkling, but I'm going to let you read me another clue, please.
Okay, next clue. The idea was later found in the 1990s when the creator was moving into a new house.
Another clue.
Next clue. The show's main character was renamed from the original idea because it sounded too much like Johnny Quest.
Yes, Johnny Quasar was the original name of Jimmy Neutron. The TV show would be The Adventures of Jimmy Neutron, Boy Genius.
Are you locking that in?
I am.
And this is for 16 points, which means if this is right, you are an instant winner. For the win, and another win at the Fame Game, is it The Adventures of Jimmy Neutron, Boy Genius? Yes, it is!
Oh, yes, yes. I will tell you the story about that. Steve Odenkirk and John Davis were the creators of the show, and John had come up with this Johnny Quasar nerdy Rocket Kid character back in the 80s. Didn't do anything with it. He was an animator and a writer. And then he was changing houses. He found an old tape that he made. He hooked up with Steve Odenkirk, who had wrote Patch Adams. He wrote a lot of stuff with Jim Carrey, very funny stand-up comedian. We did a little sizzle tape, a little short five-minute piece for Nickelodeon. Nickelodeon saw it and loved it and ordered a movie. And as we were doing the movie, they were looking at pieces of the movie and rushes, and they liked it so much, they ordered the TV series while we were making the movie. And then they changed it from Johnny Quasar to Jimmy Neutron because it sounded too much like Johnny Quest. That was the legal department at Paramount that did that.
A couple of the upcoming clues I want to share because I find them to be interesting facts. The show's pilot was aired as mini episodes, and the main character's dog was voiced by the same person that would begin voicing Scooby-Doo in 2002. Brad fact.
Frank Welker. Go to IMDb and Google Frank Welker, and you'll scroll for 3 hours. He does every weird sound effect, every weird animal. He does all kinds of characters. Super, super great guy. Incredibly versatile, incredibly talented voice actor.
So, Mark, you have 43 points, and you already won the game. But for answering correctly, you still have the opportunity to pick a number off the Fame game board.
That's true, I do, legally. You can't deny me that right.
I will certainly not deny you that right. Which number would you like, Mark?
I'm going to go with number 7. Lucky number 7, Bradley.
Number 7. Now, if this is 25 points, although it doesn't mean much financially, I think you can say you have redeemed yourself from 36 years ago when you picked the food preparer off the Fame game board instead of the $25 money card.
I can still picture the blonde model kissing his fingers with the stupid little chef hat on. Ugh, that was awful. Everyone on the show was super great. He would come up to me before every show. He was Italian. And he would say, buona fortuna, which means good luck in Italian. They were all super cool. What a great gig for them, too.
So let's find out, Mark, how many points you're adding to your already impressive score. Number 7 is worth 25 points!
Oh, unbelievable! Unbelievable!
So with a total of 68 points, Mark DeCarlo, you have continued your Sale of the Century winning streak and won this edition of the Fame Game.
Woo! Finally! 36 years later, I rehabilitate my reputation as a backer-inner.
I'm sorry I don't have $50,000 in cash or a new car, but
wait,
I think...
Wait, what? Whoa, 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 Bradley. You told me I could win myself a new convertible Tesla.
Oh, Mark, you know what? I think you got your days mixed up. Today's game was for pride and joy, but when I bring back Sale of the Century on television and invite you on for the former Grand Champions throwback tournament, that's when you'll be playing for the Tesla convertible.
Fair enough.
And that was the game of the day, the Fame Game. The Fame Game. Well, Mark, it has been a true pleasure getting the chance to talk about Sale of the Century with you. So thank you so much for joining me on the game show today.
Bradley, this was so enjoyable. A nice trip down memory lane, and the game was great, and your energy and your questions and your voice itself is excellent. I see a really bright future for you. There's digital, there's online, there's television. You could be the next great game show host. I see a very bright future for you in the game show world. And I think you certainly have a love for the genre and an understanding of what it's all about. Really, if you want to get philosophical for a minute, and maybe this is one of the reasons you like game shows, it boils down drama the same way that sports boils down drama. If you're going to watch a Shakespearean play, you watch it for 4 hours to see all the machinations and drama play out. But in a game show, it's people, their faces, and it's a contest. And someone wins and someone loses. And that is inherently dramatic. And you clearly understand that and love it as much as I do. And this was really, really fun. I'm so glad that you asked me to be on your show.
Well, that truly means the world to me. I've wanted to host game shows since I was 7 years old. I've studied the genre as best as I could. And that truly means the world to me that you noticed that.
Well, Bradley, why don't you host one? You'd be fantastic.
Well, hopefully soon. I have plenty of game show ideas ready to be produced, and I'm ready to host them as well. So, Mark, I hope you get to see me on your TV screen real soon.
I hope so. I think you'd be very, very, very successful. And when you have your show, please invite me on for a Jim Perry cameo.
I will definitely do that. No questions asked. I will definitely do that.
I would love that.
And I would love for you to join me on the game show as my guest once again in the near future to talk about your time hosting Studs and Big Deal, as well as a game show pilot that I recently discovered called Smartass, which you produced and did voice work on.
Oh, yes. Smartass. Currently, I'm doing a lot of cartoons. And are you familiar with the HQ trivia show?
Yes, of course.
Okay. So we're doing a version of that with an animated cartoon host live to air with real people. And I have an animation company now, and that's what we're working on right now. And I love game shows. I love the form. And it's kind of like the new evolution of what you can do with that form. So anytime you need me, I would love to come back and talk about any show you want.
Awesome. Well, Mark, thank you so much again for coming on the show. I had so much fun, and I'm glad you had a lot of fun as well.
You're very, very welcome, Bradley. It was a pleasure. I'm humbled and honored that you asked me to be on the show, and I had a blast. You've reacquainted me with my love for game shows.
Well, that's one of my goals in life, to spread the joy and knowledge of game shows to others. And I'm glad I accomplished that with you today, Mark. And hopefully one day we'll get to work together on a game show-related project.
I hope so. If I'm in a position to help you move forward any way, I'd be happy to do that. I really admire your work ethic, and you have enthusiasm and appreciation and an understanding of the history and the fun of this particular genre when not a lot of people do. So it was a pleasure, Bradley. Thank you so much for having me on the show, and best of luck in your career. I know you are going to be extremely successful.
Well, I truly appreciate your kindness and support, Mark. It truly means the world to me coming from someone like you. All right, Mark, take care, and I look forward to speaking with you again soon.
Thanks very much, Bradley. I appreciate you reaching out to me. That was really fun.
It was my pleasure. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
And before I sign off, it's time for another Bradley Parody. Bradley Parody. This is the segment of the game show in which I create a parody song about an aspect of this episode. And of course, today's Bradley parody is going to be inspired by the game show my guest, Mark DeCarlo, won $115,257 on back in 1985, Sale of the Century. However, the question now becomes, what song am I going to use to sing about America's biggest bargain sale? Well, for the first time in the history of the Bradley parody, I am using a song from a Disney movie. This movie was released in 1967, 2 years before the original Sale of the Century with host Jack Kelly premiered on NBC. Brad fact! And the song is one of the most popular Disney songs to this day. So, to the tune of The Bare Necessities from The Jungle Book, this is Bradley parody number 14, titled, you guessed it, Sale of the Century. When playing Sale of the Century, the game hosted by Jim Perry, you could win cars and boats and jewelry. And on Sale of the Century, where expensive gifts are so cheap, if you play well, you'll win lots of money. If you answer questions right, $5 you'll earn. During instant bargains, it might be your turn to buy a microwave oven for the price of just one question. When Jim offers you $200 in cash, your hand hits the buzzer as quick as a flash. $5 off your score. And hopefully by the game's end, you'll win lots more prizes galore. When playing Sale of the Century, the game revived in 83, you could win a nice trip to Hawaii. And on Sale of the Century, where the bargain prices can't be beat, if you play well, you'll win lots of money. Now, during the Fame game, you could pick up a prize, or one of the money cards, 10, 15, or 25. So listen to the clues closely, read by Jim so proficiently. And hit the buzzer when you know, 'cause if you're right, to the board you'll go with Summer Bartholomew. And hopefully what's revealed behind number two satisfies you. Wow, look at all the prizes I'm winning. So here comes the speed round. 60 seconds until a win or a loss. And let me tell you something, contestants. If you win, you will continue a journey towards a luxury car. But if you spend your money shopping around, you might not win after the speed round. And then what you came for won't be yours. You won't get to open the Mercedes doors. It's hurtful, but it's true. Don't ruin your game buying a bicycle bill for two. When playing Sale of the Century, the game produced by Reg Grundy, you could win a TV with a big screen. And on Sale of the Century, the amount you've won you won't believe. If you play well, you'll win lots of money. Dreams come true on Sale of the Century. While listening to Sale of the Century, I hope you are dancing around with a smile on your face like Mowgli and Baloo. And that was this episode's Bradley Parody. Bradley Parody! Well, all the instant bargains have been bought, which means we have sadly reached the end of this episode of the game show. My thanks once again to Sale of the Century Grand Champion, Mark DeCarlo, for being my special guest today. I also want to give a big shout out and thank you to DJ Bob Runkel from the DJ Bob Show for helping me connect with Mark DeCarlo. Now, Mark isn't the only guest I've had on the game show with a Sale of the Century connection. My guest on episodes number 18 and 50 was none other than Rossi Morielli, the host of Temptation, the new Sale of the Century. And Rossi actually played the Fame game for his brand new game on episode 50, his Game Redemption episode. If you want to check out both of Rossi Morielli's episodes, as well as listen to this episode again featuring Mark DeCarlo, all you have to do is log on to www.soundcloud.com/Bradley_Clarke, that's Bradley_Clarke/sets/the game show. That's www.soundcloud.com/Bradley_Clarke, that's Bradley_Clarke/sets/the game show. In addition, the game show is now on YouTube. That's right, you can listen to all episodes, game segments, Bradley parodies, and more by going onto the YouTube channel for the game show starring Bradley Clarke. And if you're a loyal friend and true, please remember to like, share, and subscribe. Plus, don't forget to like the game show starring Bradley Clarke on Facebook and follow the game show starring Bradley Clarke on Twitter using the handle at @TheGameShowBC and #TheGameShow. And of course, be sure to tune in next time for another exciting episode of The Talk Show, all about the world of television game and competition shows, The Game Show. I'm Bradley Clarke, the Bradster, and I've got to go see if I saved enough money to buy the new Mercedes-Benz. I hear it's only going for $540. Bye for now.
This edition of The Game Show was created and produced by Bradley Clarke. This is Austin Angelo speaking.
The Game Show is a Bradley Clarke production. Get your game on!